The Hopf conjectures are about 90 years old. One of the conjectures asked whether positive curvature implies positive order characteristic. The second asks whether a positive curvature is possible on the product of two spheres. The Synge conjecture of Hopf deals with even-dimensional Riemannian manifolds. Is it true that positive curvature implies that the Euler characteristic is positive, or that negative curvature leads to the expected sign? For two manifolds, there's the Gauss-Bonnet result. For four manifolds, the generalized Gauss-Bonnet Chern result works, as Milner has realized about 50 years ago. But Gauss-Bonnet stops to work already in dimension 6 or higher. The conjecture has, however, been confirmed for manifolds that are embedded in codimension 1 or codimension 2. For surfaces, a positive curvature surface looks like part of a sphere. For negative curvature, you have a saddle situation. If written as a graph of a function and rotated so that the point is a critical point, then the curvature is the discriminant D we know from multivariable calculus. Gauss discovered that this curvature is independent of an embedding of the surface. Curvature can then be expressed through length. If the length of that wavefront grows slower than 2 pi t, it's a flat case, then the surface has positive curvature. For negative curvature surfaces, the length of the wavefront grows faster than linearly. In higher dimensions, we can do the same, but along planes. Pick a two-dimensional plane and send light out in every direction to that in that plane. That produces a surface x of d, so the curvature of that surface is then defined as the sectional curvature of that plane. This means that if you blow out a smoke ring in that plane, then the length of that ring is growing slower than linearly. This positive curvature, it's growing faster than linearly. This means negative curvature. So it seems simple, but things can become already quite complicated in general. Here we see what happens in a simple surface. So this is a quartic small graph of a quartic polynomial. After some time, the smoke ring changes shapes near caustics. So here another situation closer to a hyperbolic situation, but also the curvature is getting larger outside, and so caustics start to form. Here we see kind of this dynamical system on a donut. So we have start with positive curvature, but then things start to fold up and focus on caustics. Things can become already quite complicated here. So there is already quite a bit of evidence for the conjecture. We mentioned the two and four dimensional cases, well, the codimension cases. Another important case is if curvature is sufficiently pinched, then if the surface is additionally also orientable, then one has a sphere. So these are the sphere theorems. If the ratio between highest and lowest curvature is less than 4, the manifold is simply connected and one has a sphere. So this was conjectured already by Heinz Hopf. It was proven by Harry Rauch using a stronger pinching condition and by Wilhelm Klingenberg and Marcel Berger. What does one know about positive curvature manifolds? An important result is if the manifold is orientable and has positive curvature, then M is simply connected. This is Synge theorem. It settles the Hopf conjecture in dimension 4, because then the Betti numbers B1 and B3 are a zero, so that by Euler-Poincaré formula, the Euler characteristic is positive. And so that's in the case of negative curvature, one knows that the universal cover has to be Euclidean space. This is a theorem of Cartan-Hadamard, also found by Mangold in dimension 2. There's a nice result of Priceman, a student of Hopf, who later became a hydrologist. So he proved that every non-trivial abelian subgroup of the fundamental group is Z. So this means, for example, that on a torus, on an n-dimensional torus, n bigger or equal than 2, there's no negative curvature there. Another attack for the curvatures, Hopf conjectures, is to look at the Betti numbers, or bounds of the Betti numbers. So one can compute the Betti numbers for examples one knows, like here the torus, the projective four-dimensional projective space, the phi 4 sphere, the two-dimensional projective plane, or S2 cross S2. And so this algebraic topology approach So there are some results, general results, like proof positive to proof positive Euler characters. You show the diminishing of some Betti numbers, especially the odd ones, vanishing theorems. And Bochner has developed some techniques using Hodge theory in this direction. There's a general bound by Gromov, universal dimension dependent, only dimension dependent bound on the Betti numbers for a positive curvature manifold. Some of these ideas have been ported to the discrete by Former. A huge industry has then been developed to prove the conjectures under some additional conditions, like the existence of isometric circle action, a killing field, or with more symmetries. I'm not an expert in this, but here are some mathematicians who have worked in these directions. The question of Hopf has been motivated largely by physics, as expressed by Hopf himself. Indeed, both Hilbert and Einstein got the Einstein field equations about the same time before Hopf. 10 years before Hopf started to work, these equations involved a Ricci tensor and an average of sectional curvatures containing a line through a point, or then the scalar curvature, which is the average over all sectional curvatures. So this relates then to Einstein manifolds, which are defined as manifolds for which the Ricci tensor is proportional to the metric tensor. These are vacuum solutions of the Einstein equations. Many of the known manifolds are Einstein, Berger established that unless they are flat, must have positive Euler characteristic. An inequality of Hitchin-Thorpe allows to see that some directed sums of the complex projective plane is not Einstein anymore. It is a bit difficult to spot the conjecture in the writings of Hopf. When looking through his papers, the first appearance might have been just a paper of 1932, which is a write-up of a talk he gave in 1931. The talk was given in Bad Elster in September of 1931, and also in Freiburg in Switzerland in May of 1931. So the 1931 meeting in Bad Elster is famous also because Kurt Gödel was announcing his incompleteness theorem there, and Oin Zermelo, who had similar results and gave a talk just after Gödel. The story is told by Olga Towski-Tott. An earliest place where we could find the full sign conjecture, formulated at least as a question, is a paper of Bishop and Goldberg from 1963. Interestingly, so there is no mentioning of Hopf there. So Hopf mentions the site of 31, mentions it later on also close to the sign conjecture in a talk given in 1953 in Italy, and also Chern mentions in 1966 the full conjecture. A lot then appears in Berger's Panorama, who gives a book of Berger, gives evidence that Hopf already worked in the 20s towards the understanding of these conjectures. Even so, Hopf seems not have stated such conjectures in the 1920s, to my knowledge. The product conjecture is also popularized in the book of Gromov, Kringenberg and Meyer, which also features the sphere theorem. That book had been very influential for global Riemannian geometry, and they're also kind of an encouragement for this in studying this Hopf type problems. Not so much is known about the product conjecture. Weinstein showed that it cannot be embedded in codimension 2. So one only knows in four dimensions that spheres or projective spaces have positive curvatures. Spaces like the product of the projective plane with itself does not have positive, cannot have positive curvature by Synge theorem. But there's also encouragement that there might be a kind of positive curvature because there are exotic nine spheres without non-negative curvature found by Hitchin. So another, according to Berger, motivation for Gauss-Bonnet, generalized Gauss-Bonnet, Gauss-Bonnet to higher dimension, which was an effort of more than 100 years, which started with Gauss in 1872, and was eventually finished in 1944 with Chern, so that's 120 years. Intermediate steps needed embeddings in larger dimensional spaces. surface as a hyperspace, hypersurface, that's Hopf already, and then with larger embedding, like Allendorfer, Fenchel, Weil, and finally culminating in Chern's proof, which was done intrinsically. Theorem is quite important, also important that it appears even in science fiction. This is a book by Greg Egan, Diaspora, where Gauss-Bonnet is mentioned. Gauss-Bonnet looked promising at first, also for the Hopf conjecture. Einstein showed that curvature to be positive can be decided in finite, many steps. At a four-dimensional case worked then by Milnor, who has saw that that worked, but already in dimension six, the Gauss-Bonnet chance integrand can become negative, and Robert Geroch has found the counterexample. A lot of examples of manifolds with positive curvatures have been constructed. There's an interesting conjecture of Ziller, who states that every simply connected positive curvature four manifold might be either the four sphere or the complex projective plane. And also bold that in five dimensions, any simply connected positive curvature manifold could be a sphere. The first statement would settle the product conjecture of Hopf. I myself got interested in the subject because of graphs here. In the discrete, you can ask similar questions. A nice way to go about this with Poincaré-Hopf, then take a probability space of Morse functions defining a curvature which satisfies Gauss-Bonnet. So maybe there are some index expectations which are positive everywhere. So reviving the algebraic Hopf conjecture somehow, the same question can then be asked in the discrete and explored in the discrete, where it is just allows experimentation. These are finite linear programming problems which can be decided by a computer. So there are only finitely many two-dimensional sections where one has to check the positive curvature, assume that the measure produces positive curvature, and then see whether there is maybe a counterexample. So this is it. Heinz Hopf was influencing geometry enormously. I'm fortunate that he had been teaching in Zurich, my alma mater, where he had many, many students, and quite a few of my teachers were students of Hopf.